Okay, so a very good afternoon to all the deaf persons and also to all of you. So I'll be speaking today on first to interpret FFA and ICG. Well, first we'll just run through the basics. So fluorescence is the property of fluorescence is that certain molecules emit light of a longer wavelength when stimulated by light of shorter wavelength. So this is the basic principle of the angiography. And the two dyes that we are going to talk about is one is fluorescein and the other is indocyanine green. So the basic differences between the two. So the sodium fluorescein dye is smaller than the indocyanine dye and both are impermeable to the outer and the inner retinal barrier. However, the fluorescein is 70 to 80% bound to the proteins, and that is the reason why it has the capability of extravasating from the choriocapillaries because it has fenestrations. Whereas the indocyanine green is 98% protein bound, and because it's a bigger molecule, it does not permeate that well through the choriocapillaries and it stays largely intravascular, and that helps us in studying the choroidal vasculature. So as I said, both of the dyes are impermeable to the inner and the outer retinal barrier. However, the ICG is impermeable to the fenestrated choriocapillary as well. So the excitation and emission curves of fluorescence for both fluorescein and ICG are 490 and 530 for fluorescein and 790 to 805 excitation and 835 for ICG. So as we can see, these are the filters that we use in the procedure, both for ICG and FFA. Now going on to the normal fluorescein angiogram. So it has basically five phases. So the first phase is the choroidal phase, and this happens after the dye is injected into the vein and it reaches the choroid. So it happens around about 8 to 12 seconds post dye injection, and the leakage of the fluorescein occurs through these fenestrated choriocapillaries, as I said, and that is the reason why we are not able to see the vessels of the choroid, and we get a patchy, faint, scattered sort of a fluorescence. If you need to see the ciliaretinal artery, we need to see this, we need to check in this phase as it gets its supply from the choroidal vessels. Then we go on to the arterial phase, which happens around about 10 to 15 seconds after the injection, and you can see the filling of the retinal arteries. However, there is no filling of the retinal veins as such. Then we go on to the arteriovenous phase, which is also called the capillary phase. So now the dye is traversing from the retinal artery to the capillary bed, and we can see that the retinal artery filling is almost complete and there is laminar flow in the retinal veins. Then comes the venous phase, which can be divided into early phase, mid phase and late phase, and this depends upon what kind of fluorescence that the vein has in comparison to the artery. So if it is the artery fluoresces more than the vein, then it is the early venous phase, and if both are of the same fluorescence, then it is the mid venous phase, and if the vein fluoresces more than the artery, then it is the late venous phase. As you can see in this photograph, both are of, there is complete filling of the artery and the veins, and there is similar fluorescence, it is midvenous phase. Then you go on to the late phase, that means that the artery has actually traversed the whole of the retinal vasculature and is now gone, some amount has got excreted and it comes back into recirculation. So this is called, the, in this phase, there is similar fluorescence of both the artery and the vein. However, the intensity has gone down and you will see staining of the optic nerve head. So moving on to how to interpret these angiograms. So the basic thing that we would see in all textbooks is probably the division of these lesions either as hyper or hypo, which is hyper is something, anything that seems to look bright on the angiogram, and anything that is hypo and dark is that first differentiation is that. And then we will think about the characteristics of that hyperfluorescence, whether it increases in size and intensity, and in case of a hypo, the level at which the blockage occurs. Now, apart from this normal standard hyper and hypo that we look for, the next step that we should think is when this hyper and hypo is actually occurring. So which phase is it? So it can be a delayed or a patchy filling, or any of these hyper or hypo lesions might come in any of these particular phases of the angiogram. And lastly, any characteristic leak, that means that if we are suspecting any particular pathology, so any characteristic leak that is there specific to that pathology. So first we will go for hypo and hyper. So any hyperfluorescence can then be differentiated into four, which is either a window defect, a leakage, pooling or a staining, and likewise hypo can be differentiated into block fluorescence and filling defects. Another hyperfluorescence is pseudofluorescence, which is a flake fluorescence. It happens due to non-fluorescent structures being fluorescent, and this is because of the mismatch and aging of the filters. That is why we take controlled photographs to look for any pseudofluorescence. So the first two fluorescence is the transmission on the window defect, and as you can see, this is the early, it is the arterial phase, and you can see that there is the central area in which you can see the choroidal vasculature, and this is a hyper, and it occurs early in the choroid phase and the early arterial phase, and intensity increases with the choroidal filling. However, they do not increase in size and tend to fade away as the choroid empties. These are the doses, and these also fluoresce and they tend to fade away as the choroid empties. The next hyperfluorescence is leakage. As you can see, from a pipe, it leaks in the same ways. There is a hyperlesion that is there seen in the early venous phase, and it tends to increase in intensity and increase in size as we go along to the late venous phase and more so in the recirculation phase. These are most typically seen for new vascularization of retina and new vascularization of the disc. Then the next one is pooling. As you can see the photograph, it's like filling of an anatomic space, and there is increase in size and the fluorescence up to the time it fills that anatomic space, and subsequent to which there is no increase in size. So as you can see, there is hyperfluorescence, it increases in intensity and it increases in size until it fills that distinct space. In such cases, we're seeing more commonly in CSR and PED, and it fills either the NSD or the pigment epithelial defect. The next hyperfluorescence is staining, in which you can see there is slight hyperfluorescence which is occurring along the angiogram and keeps increasing slowly as we go along in the late phases and more so in the recirculation phase. The size remains the same, but margins might get blurred, and you can typically see the disc staining that happens in recirculation phase. These are more seen in cases where wherever there are scars, either in cases of these hip choroid arteries or even old choroidal neovascular membranes. Now moving on to hypolesions. The hypolesions can either be block fluorescence or filling defects, as I said, and the block fluorescence can then block either the retinal vasculature or the choroidal vasculature. If it is obscuring the retinal vasculature, then it can be something that might be in the anterior segment, like a PCO or a PSC, or in the vitreous, like a vitreous hemorrhage, or in the inner retina, like intraretinal hemorrhages or exudates. If it is blocking the choroidal vasculature, then it can either be deep retina or subretinal bleed or sub-RP bleed. As you can see in this photograph, different levels of bleeds can obscure the underlying vasculature. So this is an example of a block fluorescence, in which you can see this is a RP hyperplasia, and when you do a subsequent angiogram, you can see the block fluorescence corresponding to it. The next hyperfluorescence is filling defects. Filling defects are nothing but non-perfusion areas, and as you can see, all these areas are non-perfused, and you see these cases typically in a case of vasculitis, as seen over here. The peripheral CNPs are there, and also seen in patients with diabetes where the CNPs are more posteriorly. Another example in which there you might see block and filling defects as well, so you need to correlate it with the clinical photograph. As you can see over here, there is no hemorrhages in the clinical photograph, but there is hypoperfusion on the angiogram. So this is a filling defect, whereas there is a hemorrhage in the clinical photograph and there is a hypofluorescent lesion. This is a block fluorescence. So the next question that we ask is, which phase is it? Why is the phase important? So if we need to look for something like a cilioretinal artery, it's best to see in the choroidal phase because it gets a supply from the choroidal phase. If you want to look for choroidal ischemia, such as in OIS, you probably would want to see it in the choroidal phase or more so in the early arterial phase. Then in the arterial phase, the something like central retinal artery, you can see that there is a delay in arm to retina time. Arm to retina time is generally 8 to 12 seconds, and anything more than that will then identify, probably signal you towards a central retinal artery occlusion. As you see, there is delayed filling of this of the arteries, and the veins have still not flown, and there is lot of non-perfusion areas present posteriorly. So arterial phase would reveal a central retinal artery occlusion. Again, another lesion in the arterial phase, if it hyperforces along the retinal artery, and you can see the corresponding vein just showing laminar flow, that means it is the arterial phase, and this lesion might be a retinal artery macroaneurysm. But the similar lesion which is present along in the arteriovenous or the late venous phase, then that lesion is more likely to be a venous macroaneurysm. Then if you're looking for macular details specifically for the FAZ and you are suspecting macular ischemia, the best possible best possible phase to assess for macular ischemia is the arteriovenous phase, in which you can see the dimensions of the FAZ. If you are going to see it in the late phase, then you'll probably miss out on the diagnosis. Likewise, again, if you're looking for NVEs, although they might show thin vessels in the early venous phase, however, they tend to start leaking only in the late and the recirculation phase. The next, I'll give you a few examples of some characteristic leaks in certain pathologies. So if you get such a photograph, if you're getting such an angiogram in a setting of a female patient having vasculitis and having these microaneurysms along the retinal artery, then you are going for a diagnosis of Irvine. Again, a small boy having unilateral diminution of vision, having bulb-like dilatation and telangiectic vessels, gives away the diagnosis of Coats. The next is how to interpret ICG. Well, it goes more or so in the lines of FA itself. However, the hyper and hypo is a bit different than the FA. So in hyper, we are not going to assess for size and intensity because not much of leakage is there. However, we are going to look for any abnormal vessels and any leakage that happens in the late phases. For hypo, it's more or less similar only, like a blood nevus or a CHRP blocking the underlying choroidal fluorescence. And a PED, which is totally different from a fluorescein angiogram where it fluoresces. Here it is a hypo structure because owing to the non-leakage of the ICG. The next, again, we will go to see which phase is it and also any characteristic pathologies which might be seen. So if you compare the normal ICG to a normal FA, it has different phases. So the early phase is when the filling of the choroidal arteries occurs and the disc is hypofluorescent at that point of time because of the watershed zone. Mid phase is divided into early mid and late mid. The early mid where the prominence of choroidal veins occurs and the late mid where the fading of the choroidal vessels occur. And there is diffuse hyper, which becomes even more hyper in the late phases. Now, as you see in the early phase, the disc is hypo and the choroidal arteries are filling. In the early mid phase, the veins are now becoming prominent and the disc is not exactly hyper, but is now fluorescing. Late mid, in which the fading of the choroidal vessels occur. Now, some of the pathologies that that are useful, some of the pathologies useful is central serous choroidopathy, in which you can see these hyperpachy vessels that are there corresponding to the leak that you see in a fluorescein angiogram. And these in the late phases show either a focal leak or a diffuse leak. Again, polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy is another pathology which is typically best seen in ICG. So the early phases will show this hyper branch vascular network, which will keep increasing in fluorescence and will show these terminal bulbs. And these polyps then fill and start leaking in the later phases. Another diagnosis which might be better seen on an ICG as retinal angiomatous proliferans, in which you see there is a anastomosis between the choroid and the retinal vasculature. So as you can see, there is a retinal a feeder arterial and a draining retinue and few telangiectic vessels. On an ICG, you can see the block fluorescence and this typical hairpin look is characteristic of a RAP. Few lesions of the choroid like a VKH.
All due respect, Dr. Shorya, I would request you to please sum it up in the next minute because we are running short of time.
So, like VKH, there is hyperfluorescence disc leak on a fluorescein angiogram. However, we will not see it on an ICG, but we will see the dark spots in the late mid phase, which are corresponding to the choroidal hypoperfusion that is seen in VKH. Then in cases of tumors like a melanoma, a small choroidal melanoma may just show a block fluorescence, but the margins and margins might be seen better on an ICG. And lastly, a peripheral lesion like a peripheral exudative hemorrhagic chorioretinopathy, which might be seen on a wide field angiography, in which you are seeing a block fluorescence, which might be a sub-RPE bleed and a polyp corresponding to it. To summarize, to interpret the FA and ICG, we should know the basics of the ICG. We should know how the dye passes through the retinal vasculature, normal versus abnormal. For example, arm to retina time. We should know the differentials for hyper and hypo lesions. And in case we are suspicious of a pathology, we should focus on that eye or a particular face.